Good morning. Would like to also wish you women a happy Mother's Day. It is a blessed gift to man to have women, and so we celebrate, in many ways, we celebrate all women today. It's a wonderful blessing. God gave us women because he wanted the world to have orderliness, and it would be a sty if it weren't for the fact that we have women. And I remember one of my teachers when I was going to Bible college, Bible school, he said, he informed us of some important information that's not in the Bible, but it's implied there very, very carefully, very clearly. And he said that when Adam named Eve, you know, God gave Adam that responsibility to name certain things, and Adam would reflect the image of God in that way. And so when he called Eve woman, it was because when God first brought Eve to the man, he said, "Whoa, man!" And so she became woman. You know, so we are blessed to have our women. What a wonderful gift that God has given us. Not like the animal creation, right? As blessed as the animal creation is to have pairs and couples of male and female, God intentionally created Eve not out of the dust, but out of Adam, out of the rib of Adam, that bone closest to the heart, and then brought them together so that the two would become one flesh. So there is a blessed unity that a man has with a woman, a completeness there. And when you have a woman who is after God's heart, a quiet and gentle spirit, a woman who is beautiful on the inside, that means everything to the Lord. So just want to wish you all a happy Mother's Day and a happy Woman's Day, I guess you can say, in a lot of ways. And that goes a long way in a culture that doesn't even know how to define a woman. In our Supreme Court, even at this point, with one of the individuals on there, we need to recognize our women. If you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6, we're moving toward the end of this book. And I'm thinking of probably going to look to preach through the Gospel of Mark. After this, I wanted to preach to a gospel. I've yet to preach to a full gospel, and so please pray for me, because every time I've attempted to preach to a full gospel, in some way I've been put out of commission. I went through 6 chapters of John, and then I had to go on sabbatical for a while after suffering from a condition back in New York. And then I was preaching to the Gospel of Matthew, and I went to about 13 or 14 in that area, and then God called me here. So I haven't gotten to a gospel yet, but I picked Mark because it's short enough so that I'm hoping I can make it through it and still survive and not have something else happen to take me out. But I love to walk with Christ in the Gospels. It's just so many rich applications there, and I know that it gives me an appreciation of Christ in a very special way, and that always spills into the theology of the Gospel that's taken from the epistles and other aspects of Scripture. So please be praying about that the Lord would bless our time together and enrich us as we journey with Christ through that shorter gospel of Mark. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. Let's hear the word of the Lord. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak." Let's pray. Father, as we look at this text, It's an integral part of our survival, our growth, and our success in the battle is to put on the armor that comes from you, because we face spiritual beings. Our primary war is not against flesh and blood and material things, even though those things do influence us and come against us, but it's the spiritual realities that lie behind these things where the real power lies. And so if we're going to stand firm and to fight the good fight of faith and to lay hold of eternal life and to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace in the church, if we're going to preserve and preserve our marriages and persevere in our marriages and our parenting, if we're going to persevere in our commitment to being faithful employers and employees, we need to have this armor on every single day. So Lord, please give us grace to believe. Give us grace to apply these things, not just to have them in our minds, but to have them in our hearts. We ask that you would give us grace now and forgive us for our sins. Fill us with your Spirit, Father, so that these things would bring conviction to us in a powerful way through grace for change. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Coming to the end of this precious epistle to the Ephesians, last time we began to consider the Apostle Paul's final words of exhortation. This is the end of this book. Again, it is believed that it is a circular letter that went through the churches, at least in Asia Minor, in that area, similar to what John the Apostle was writing in the Revelation. That circuit there is believed to be the recipient of this letter. And having spent then the first three chapters unveiling God's glorious plan of redemption and the incomprehensible privilege given to all those who are truly united to Christ by faith, those three glorious chapters of Ephesians, maybe go back and read them again on your own, because they are the power, the motivation, the thrust that would encourage us and exhort us and compel us to obey the commands that are given in the last three chapters. And so we recognize how, again, God motivates us by truth. He gives us the indicatives so that we will obey the imperatives. And then finally, we come now to this section of expressing the importance of putting on God's armor so that we can stand in this battle, so that we can fight this good fight and be faithful to God to the end, hearing those wonderful and amazing words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And so he closes with this sobering exhortation. Last time we began to see how this exhortation has called us to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might, because prosperity in our Christian walk will not come without a fight. The Christian walk is not a cakewalk. It is not easy. It's not say this prayer, come to the Lord, and everything is smooth from here. In fact, a lot of times it gets more intense, more difficult. We're in grace. We have peace with God. We have rest in Christ. But it's a battle, a fight to be faithful to the end. For those who wish to serve and glorify Christ will face great opposition throughout the course of their Christian walk. And we are, in fact, in war with those who desire to can't contend with God himself. We have to remember that while the enemy does come after us, while he wants to destroy the church, his primary enemy, the primary one we're seeking to fight against, is Christ and his church and his glory. That's why he comes after us. And so if he can destroy his church, as it were, he would eclipse the glory of Christ that is bound within the church. And our truest and most fierce enemies, that which sobered us hopefully last week, we focused on just knowing the enemy, because we saw how important that is. Our truest and most fiercest enemies are immaterial spiritual beings. They are higher powers, we're told, principalities, a great multitude of dark demonic devils led by Satan himself, that serpent of old, who's well experienced, who's wise of the things of this world, who knows how to trick and deceive, who is cunning and crafty, and who works from within the spiritual realm of the heavenly places where he's not seen by the naked eye. That realm that coexists and overlaps our physical realm. And though these demonic beings are unseen, they are indeed very powerful. And they are very active in influencing all that takes place in our physical world. Last time, hopefully we got at least a small taste of the reality of this opposition and the reality of the spiritual battle that is always taking place, so that we might, with a sense of urgency and sobriety, act and move to daily ensure that we are well equipped for this battle. Last week was a call, a charge to say, be equipped. Be well equipped. You will be victorious in Christ. Greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. But we have a responsibility as Christians to fight this battle. It's not just to sit back and say, well, God is sovereign. He is sovereign. But in His sovereignty, He also is ordained to have us cooperate with the Holy Spirit, as it were, in this battle, so that we would fight against spiritual enemies and succeed in Christ. But thanks be unto God that the apostle moves on to tell us here in our text that there's a type of armor that exists. And this armor is entirely accessible at all times. You ever see some of those movies where they're trying to find that particular sword or that particular shield that you need, they need to defeat the enemy? And it's always this big hunt and digging into mountains and caves and fighting great enemies just to get that tool. Well, for us, the armor is accessible to us. We don't have to search for it out there somewhere in the world. And that armor is fit to equip us to engage in the exact type of battle that we are called to fight. And that armor is freely accessible to us. Always, it is the armor of God. Well, this morning then, I would like us to consider this invaluable armor that God provides, so that we might daily put it on. Daily put it on. Guaranteeing our ultimate victory in Christ. How many people have I seen through my own life, my own walk, and I know you probably can relate to this, who seem to be the greatest soldiers out there. They were like chiefs of the armies early on, doing so well, only to fall away or to drift later on and to fail to finish faithfully that race. Maybe in some cases even proving that they were not genuine, that they were in a soil that was not even well grounded. We've seen it. We know about it. It's not those who start the race who win the prize. It's those who finish the race and continue on persevering to the end. And so, brethren, we ought to see this final exhortation as both a warning and an encouragement. It's a warning to take note that this battle is not something to be taken lightly or carelessly, lest we be overcome and ultimately defeated. But it's also an encouragement to know that we must and will have success if we put on the armor of God, which God freely gives us through Christ. So let's look now at the armor of God in verses 14 to 20. We'll look at each piece here to 20. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes to your feet, for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace, in all circumstances taking up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I might declare it boldly as I ought to speak. And so, in keeping with what we've gone over in verses 10 to 13, we see again that in putting on the armor of God, we are setting ourselves primarily in a defensive posture. It's a defensive posture so that we might withstand, so that we might resist, we might stand against and oppose the wicked schemes of the devil. The devil will attack. His minions will attack. The opposition will come against us. And our primary function is not to provoke the devil. It's not to act arrogantly against him, but it's to withstand him. We know who the one who will slay him ultimately is, but we are to withstand. We are to be defensive in that sense. We're to maintain our ground, being immovable from our cause. and our purpose in Christ, not allowing him to shift us to the right or to the left. And so as Paul begins to define the armor of God and how it is put on, he begins in verse 14 by repeating what he has said two other times already. He says, stand therefore, that you may be able to withstand, that you may be able to stand. Stand therefore. In light of the type of opposition you are facing, and in light of the fact that you must stand against it, he says, stand by doing the following. So now he's going to present to us the armor that we need to put on so that we can stand. Isn't it wonderful that Paul is not vague? Sometimes we tell people to do things, even our children, and we're very vague. Just do this. But Paul never leaves us in the dark. The Holy Spirit of God gives us the how to do this as well. First, he says, first, therefore, right, take up the whole armor of God to be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth. Paul here begins, interestingly enough, with that part of the armor. And he has in mind the Roman soldier here. They would have known very well, the Ephesians, right? Primarily a Gentile area, Gentile region. They would have known what the Roman soldiers looked like. They were all over the place, stationed, not only there in Asia Minor, but throughout the whole Roman Empire. And say they would have known. And he says, stand therefore. And he begins with this piece of armor which would have held all of the undergarments and the tunic together in place so that it would allow the soldier to move unhindered in the battle. If he didn't have a belt on, everything would hang down and fall down, and if you tried to run out in battle, you would trip, you would fall, you would be clumsy, you would be unstable. You would not be able to maintain your stance and to use the rest of your armor effectively. And then furthermore, the belt was also used to protect the abdomen from injury. I want to suggest two ways in which we can understand this belt of truth. First, this involves our steadfast confidence in God's truth. It is our unflinching commitment and resolve to accept, believe, and obey God's truth at all times that secures everything together. It enables us to withstand any whisper of doubt from the enemy. Our commitment to the truth keeps everything else together. It holds the sword that you wield in place. It's the belt also holds the sword in place. Without such confidence in the truth, our sword will fall away from us. Our armor will shake loose and we will not be able to stand. And I believe, brethren, that this is our commitment to the authority, infallibility, sufficiency of Scripture. It's amazing today how many people don't even have a belt of truth in many churches that are out there. When you compromise on the authority of God's word, when you go loose with God's word and you allow for error, when you allow human reasoning and human logic to supersede what God's word says, the belt is loosened, everything falls out, you are unstable. And that's why so many churches collapse over time, because they compromise on that most foundational truth that holds everything together, that this is God's word. It is infallible. It cannot fail. It must be true in all of its parts, and it is wholly sufficient for everything we need to know for salvation and how to live a godly life. Second, there's another reason this belt is important. In Psalm 51:6, we're told that God desires truth in the inward parts. In the inward parts. And so we're to gird ourselves with sincerity and truth. Not Pharisaic religion. Not plastic religion. Not outward show. Not just showing up on Sundays and looking the Christian part. But sincerity and truth. With a genuine desire to remain faithful to God at all costs without hypocrisy. Genuine and authentic, pure and undefiled religion. It's to be the lace that keeps our armor together. Commitment to the truth. Confidence in this truth. And when our hearts compromise or we disagree with this, we go with this and lean not on our own understanding. This is the basis of our faith. And brethren, if this church, God forbid, ever should come to the point where we question the infallibility and authority of this word, then you need to take whoever's leading that church and oust them out of the building and out of the church altogether. Secondly, there is a second part to this armor. First, it's that commitment to the truth. Secondly, we're told, if you look again in verse 14, stand therefore having fastened on the belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness. Here Paul calls us to put on that essential piece of armor. What an essential piece of armor the breastplate was to the Roman soldier. Why? Why was it so important to wear the breastplate? Because it protected the most vital of all organs, your heart. It guarded the heart. Only the breastplate of righteousness is suitable for that kind of protection. We're to guard our hearts. Let me suggest two ways in which we can apply this. First, Paul calls us to protect our hearts from the accusations of the enemy. We're going to see about this in a little bit with the shield of faith, that there are arrows that would sink into our hearts and seek to sink us into despair, to question our salvation, to get to the point where we feel like we can't go on, which will lead us to divide the body and will affect every relationship that's given to us in Ephesians. If we're not secure, we can't secure anything else unless we are grounded in Christ. And so he would seek to accuse us. And that breastplate of righteousness is Christ's righteousness, as it were, which was given to us by his atonement. And we've received it by faith. And it is the only sure and stable ground that can enable us to withstand the enemy's accusations. What is the tendency for many Christians? It's one or the other. Either we become too loose in our walk and take Christ for granted, and that's dangerous and antinomian. Or the other extreme is we become so strict to the sense that we begin to measure our relationship with God based upon how well we are doing, our righteousness. And that is a sure plan of failure, because we will find that we are in a battle. We're in sanctification. We're in that walk. And we fall short, and we constantly need to draw from grace. Constantly need to draw from the righteousness of Christ, recognizing that we are covered by his righteousness. And that while he is forming us into his image, if you take off his righteousness, we are still ugly and defiled and unacceptable to God. And so we constantly need that breastplate of righteousness. We must continually remember who we are in Christ, and that our justification is anchored in his victory and not in our progress. Secondly, though, Paul would also have us withstand the enemy's attacks, protecting our most vital organ by remaining faithful and steadfast in our pursuit of godliness and righteous living. And so there is not only a reliance on the righteousness of Christ, but that reliance on his righteousness also gives us a determination to imitate it, to pursue that same righteousness in our living. We're to let righteousness, defined not by the world, but by the word of God, shield and protect our hearts. We're to guard our hearts, as the scriptures constantly tell us, for out of them flow the issues of life. Our hearts are constantly running after idols, constantly seeking to run away from the Lord, constantly wayward by nature. And so we are to guard our hearts, to not allow them to wander carelessly and aimlessly, lest we be overtaken and entangled in sin, which so easily ensnares us. Our hearts are like a little children in the toy store. If you don't keep an eye on them and watch them, they run all over the place. And we need to keep them by us. You guard your children when you're in the toy store or wherever you go, because you know there are enemies out there. There are people who would abduct them or take them, and somebody might snatch them. And so you keep an eye and you say, wait a second, where's Johnny? Where is Melissa? Where are they? Wait, we got to make sure they're right here next to us at all times. We guard them. And it's not convenient. It's uncomfortable because we like to look around in different places, whether we're at the grocery store or wherever we are. But we guard our children. We need to guard our hearts. In 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 8, Paul says, but let us who are of the day be sober. Not drunk, but sober. Clear-minded. Putting on the breastplate, he says there, of faith and love. Third, the third piece of armor. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. Here, we're called to bind our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. On the battlefield, the Lord would have us wear those protective, sturdy sandals, which would help protect our steps and keep us stable for the duration of the war. Back in that time, they didn't have combat boots. The soldiers had on these sturdy sandals that were tied up. And if they were, you wouldn't have anything where the soles were imbalanced, because you know that your feet have to be able to, you have to be able to run without falling or tripping because of the inconvenience of poorly made sandals. They helped you to maintain your balance. And I want to suggest to you two ways in which we can understand this. First, Paul would have us walk wholly in the peace of the gospel of grace at all times, enabling us to protect our steps as well as to keep us stable, so that we might stand firm and endure the wicked schemes of the devil. The whole idea of standing assumes we need to be balanced. We need to be firm. We need to be pressing, in a sense, forward and not easily be knocked off. And so the sandals are important to help us stand firm. And so, brethren, we must continually remind ourselves daily that we stand protected in the gospel of God's grace and peace, not as a means of enabling sin to abound, but as a means of finding continued rest, peace, and forgiveness in all times of need. We need to be a people of the gospel, living out of the gospel. The gospel is not just for the unsaved. It's always for the Christian as well. And every step that we take must be taken as a step in the gospel. We must, in fact, preach the gospel to ourselves. There was a nice book that a dear brother from Wales once wrote. His name was Peter Jeffrey. And he wrote a book called Believers Need the Gospel. Secondly, though, referring to that same armor, Paul would have us walk in the peace of the gospel at all times, by having us consistently proclaim it in word and by example wherever we go. It should be something that is in our hearts. We desire to get out that light of the gospel to others wherever we go, wherever our feet take us in life. The gospel, which is central to the whole of our lives, ought to be carried with us wherever we go. Paul, quoting Isaiah in Romans chapter 10, verse 15, says, "How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things." Feet shod with the gospel, stable with the gospel, wherever we go. Peter tells us in 1 Peter 3, 15 and 16, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed." We need to be ready in case Nicodemus happens to come to us at night. We need to be ready if we happen upon a Samaritan woman by the well. We need to be ready wherever we go, wherever we are, prepared to give the gospel. Brethren, evangelism is not the work of the pastors or the evangelists or the missionaries. It is the work of every Christian. Every Christian has that responsibility. And then next, he moves on to say, "In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one." You see, when the Roman soldier went out to battle, he first soaked his large shield. They had those large shields that covered the whole body. He soaked it in water. He bathed it in water and left it in water. This was a means so the soldier could have the shield, would be able to put out flaming arrows that could be shot against him. You see, the shield was a great and essential source of protection because it covered the whole body. And even when archers shot lit arrows at the shield, because the shield was first saturated in water, the fiery arrows would be quenched. Well, likewise, the Apostle Paul tells us that we have such a spiritual shield which will prevent the fiery arrows of our enemies from reaching or burning us. But we must, he says, in all circumstances, notice that language, above all else, always, in all circumstances, have on or up the shield of faith. And I believe, brethren, that this shield is our settled conviction upon the truth and promises of God's word. Yes, we believe in the authority of God's word, the belt of truth. We are convinced that this is God's word, but we must be convinced that the truth in this word and the promises of this word belong to us. And brethren, no matter how difficult the battle gets, no matter how dark the path becomes, and we've been through those dark valleys. I know many of you have, if not all of you, been through those dark valleys. We must always cling to that which we know to be true in God's word. You will be tempted to trust in your subjective feelings. How many times are we trusting in our subjective feelings? We are a feeling-oriented person, but God has taught us, and He is teaching us by faith that we need to trust in His objective word, the objective promises that no matter what we feel, God supersedes our feelings. When we are wounded and weary, when we feel as if we can hardly take another step forward, maybe the helmet of salvation has gotten knocked off a bit to some extent. Maybe the breastplate of righteousness is shifted a bit on our shoulders. Yet we can persevere, clinging wholeheartedly to the reality, even then, that we know whom we have believed and are persuaded that He is able to keep that which we've committed to Him against that day. He is faithful. Even when we fall short, even when we doubt, even when the times are dark, we can still hold on to objective truth in God's word. When God is accused, when circumstances would drive the ungodly to curse God, we must stand behind the shield of Job. Think of Job's circumstances. And what did he say? The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Job had to trust in objective truth when it was very tempting to say, why is God doing this to me? How can God be good? I've done nothing wrong. All I've done has been generous to others. And even my wife is telling me to curse God. But he knew objectively that in all these doubts and fears and accusations and words coming in, that he had to hold up that shield of faith and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Somehow, in some way, I must accept evil from God even as I accept good and know that He is good. When our own consciences would question God, our settled conviction, our resolve must be, let God be true and every man a liar. That's what it comes down to. We all know Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. How many times has that been a rescue text for each of us? Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Don't lean on what you understand, but trust Him. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. Stay faithful. Glorify God in those circumstances, and He will direct your paths. He will be there. He'll get you through the dark cave, the twisting pathways. He will bring you to that desired end. Just trust Him and don't lean on the understanding. David, when you're out in the land of the Philistines after having destroyed the giant Goliath, and you're running to the Philistines because King Saul is out to kill you, and you have to fake that you're insane because you know these people are not friendly toward you. How do you trust that God is somehow going to direct your path to the king? You can't lean on your own understanding. You trust Him and you acknowledge Him, and He'll bring you to that place that He's promised. Brethren, by faith, we know what we are up against. And furthermore, we know who is on our side. We know who it is that has overcome the world for us. Isn't it a wonderful thing that God doesn't say, you must overcome the world, but He says, praise be unto God. He, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, He has overcome the world. Amen. Greater is He who is in you
than he was in the world.
Put on the armor of God. Trust God. Trust his objective truth. Because even though the enemy is strong, and even though he has a myriad of demonic beings that are working with him, and even though they're much naturally much stronger than you are, greater is he who is inside of you than he who is in the world. We know who will finish the work that he's begun on us, in us. Isn't it a wonderful thing to be able to stop in the middle of our Christian walk, having walked with God for so many years and just feeling it sometime. Again, you're like Pilgrim's Progress. You're in that place where you just can't see the celestial city too well. It's a dark time. It's a difficult time. And there's suffering and there's trial. And there's the temptation toward doubts. Isn't it good to always look back and say, I know who began this. And he will finish it. We know that we can resist the devil and he will flee. James 4:7. We know that while there are numerous devils in the heavenly places, we know that our God and Savior is ruler over the heavenly places. And if God be for you, brethren, who can be against you? We stand with Christ. We stand with the one who has myriads of angels watching over us and protecting us. We stand with the one who says in Romans chapter 8 that we are more than conquerors in Christ. Isn't it sufficient to be a conqueror in Christ? Yeah, it's great to be a conqueror. That seems to be sufficient. And God says, no, you're more than a conqueror. What does it even mean to be more than a conqueror? Other than the fact that God is saying that it's not even an inkling of a possibility that you will not persevere and overcome all of your enemies in Christ. Above all, brethren, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench some of the fiery darts of the wicked one. Is that what it says? With which you will be able to quench all, every single fiery dart of the enemy that hits that shield of faith will be quenched. John tells us in his first epistle, in 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith, the shield of faith. Who is he who overcomes the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. And then fifthly, he says in verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation. Take the helmet of salvation. Protect your minds. We've talked about protecting the heart. Protect your minds with the hope of salvation. Remember that which lies just beyond the cross. Set your minds on things above where Christ is. How many times have I stopped in the middle of a week and said, well, wait a second here. There is all this reality and I'm entangled in it. But wait a second here. I'm in Christ. I'm going to heaven. I've been saved from my sins. And suddenly those problems become small. 1 Thessalonians 5:8. Again, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. Brethren, if we're going to withstand in the evil day, if we're to resist the wiles of the enemy, then we must have our backs to the world and our attention fixed on the prize. Philippians 3:12-14. One of the most abused texts. How many times, and I'm not saying there's no application in this way, but how many times do we read this text and we think about forgetting our sins or the bad things that we've done? Oh, you've done that. It's in the past. Forget and go on. That's true. In Christ, we can put it behind us, but that's not what this text means. Notice Paul says, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. I have not apprehended. I have not reached the end. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. What is Paul saying here? He forgets his accomplishments. He forgets even the good things that he does. He doesn't hang his hat on past successes. He says, yes, those are wonderful. They're sown in Christ. They'll have their reward. But I don't hang my hat on them and say, well, at least I started well.
At least I've done these things and I went out and I ministered the gospel to these Gentiles. He says, I forget all that and I keep pressing on and I keep pushing forward with the gospel until I push through that finish line, and then I will rest and see the reward come. He's talking about positive things that he's done, not resting in those things. Well, I started well. Yeah, I remember I was such a diligent lover of Christ and the gospel, and I know now that I've kind of drifted and become casual, but I look back at what I've done, and Paul says, forget the past in that sense, and you get your tail to that finish line, and don't stop until you cross it. You keep persevering and being faithful to the end. That's the point of that text. Not simply to forget your failures. And then the last two things, finally, the last piece of the armor. He says, and in verse 17, take the helmet of the salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times. We'll talk about praying at all times in a moment, and especially we'll carry that over. We're going to spend a whole message just on that portion there, dealing with praying for leadership. But the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It is the word of God, which is in fact living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit. You can't separate soul and spirit. They're the same thing. And of joints and marrow. You can't separate joints and marrow. It is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. But the word of God is that sharp. It is the word of God alone which takes us through the dark trials, being a lamp for our feet and a light to our path. Indeed, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, what did he do in his path of temptation? How did he disarm the devil after he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights and was starving? He used the word of God to disarm every temptation that was brought to him. If the belt of truth, our confidence in God's word, is that which holds the sword in place, then furthermore, it is the very sword itself that must be accessed and used in that confidence. We must daily be in the scriptures, brethren. Daily be in the scriptures. We must daily be in the scriptures. Reading, meditating, studying. No, I'm not putting a time limit on that. You have to do it for an hour or 2 hours. It has to be something, though. Studying. Learning to use that sword so that we might stand in the evil day. One of the things we were taught at our arms training at Jeremiah's house is it's good to do dry run training, right, daily. I had a problem which when I was shooting, I had a problem shooting low. It was a reaction to the recoil of the gun, and I would shoot, and the bullet would always go a little lower. But I was told that if you practice dry runs, in other words, empty out all the bullets and just practice the shooting. Practice. Eventually it becomes second nature to you. Well, how many of you are not picking up that sword and practicing with it daily? And maybe this is the only place you're even in the Word of God. That is dangerous. You say, well, I have a lot of work to do. Well, you need to lessen that work. It needs to be a priority. That needs to be a priority. Seek first the kingdom of God, and he'll provide all those things. That's not just for the unbeliever. That's for the believer. Put his kingdom first. We must daily be in the scriptures. We must be good and faithful stewards of the word of God, that sword. And if we grow lazy in our devotions, let us not be blame God in the day of our downfall. Oh, God must have let me go. How could God let me go? How could he let me be given over to this temptation? Are you in the word? Well, that's your responsibility. Brethren, it's important for us as we go over these things to recognize again that this armor is something that must be put on repeatedly every day. You don't put on armor once and say, okay, I put my armor on. I did it yesterday. I did it every single day for the last 30 years. Okay, that's great. Forget what's behind and go forward and keep putting it on. We need to wake up every morning. And one of the things we need to add to our routine, when we brush our teeth or we shower, we eat breakfast, we get dressed, those things, is we need to ask ourselves, why am I here and who am I serving today? And am I ready to go to work? Am I ready to mother my children? Am I ready to do whatever it is that's in front of me this day in such a way that I know why I'm here and who I'm serving? Do I have this armor on? Am I ready? Do I have that helmet of salvation on? Is salvation ruling the mind? Is righteousness ruling the heart? Is the belt of truth my confidence in God's word as I get into that word? Is it that which is holding everything together? Am I having the gospel ready to go wherever I go with me? Ask yourself those two questions. Every morning, put it on a piece of paper on your wall. Why am I here and who am I serving? And then finally, Paul says, perhaps that which is neglected most of all. I can tell you for myself, it's a lot easier to read the word to read than it is to do what Paul says here. But I believe it's essential to everything. He says, praying at all times in the Spirit. At all times, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance. Remember what did Jesus say to his disciples when he was in the garden? Watch and pray, lest you be tempted, right? Making supplication, here's the content of our prayers, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, Paul says, the Apostle Paul, asking for prayer. We'll go over this next time. That words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel for which I'm an ambassador in chains, that I may be able to declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Praying always with all prayer in the Spirit, according to God's will. Praying according to God's will. Well, how can we pray according to God's will? Use the sword of the Spirit and you'll know. Praying in keeping with the word of God. Being watchful to this end. With the word, brethren, must come prayer. You can't separate the two any more than you can separate a communication, an interaction that is profitable between two people where both are speaking and listening. You need both. Going out to battle with the assured help of the Holy Spirit. You want the Holy Spirit to go out with you to battle? You can't do it on your own. You have to pray. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Praying according to the will of God for progress and victory for Christ's church. Brethren, if we're going to be awake, if we're going to remain alert and steadfast at all times and not be asleep in the world, if we're going to remember why we are here, who we are serving, if we're going to stand our ground, not allowing the enemy to sink his teeth into us, then we must be consistently daily in prayer, and we must be in prayer together, corporately. We must pray together. Now, we do pray at the fellowship meal together, and that's a blessing. But we have a midweek prayer meeting on Thursdays. We do it on Zoom because it's to be easy. I would love to have it right here in this building, but I don't think everybody will come. So we try to do it in a way that's convenient. And you know what? When we pray together, the few of us who come to that prayer meeting, Tracy, tremendous blessing to us. Cal, BJ, when you come, our prayers are feeble. They're stutteringly prayed. They take effort. They don't pique our interest like when you're sitting down watching TV or a nice movie. It's inconvenient, it's uncomfortable, it's difficult, they're repetitive, they're redundant. But God uses those feeble prayers through the intercession of Christ and the work of the Spirit. And He does great things. We all love Charles Spurgeon, I think so. And we all look at the success of that ministry that he had. But if you go back and look at what Charles Spurgeon said about the success of the ministry of the church, he said it has to do with the boiler room, with the people who were praying. In fact, he went on to say that prayer is one of the necessary means, the necessary cogs in the wheels of God's providence. Yes, God is sovereign. Yes, God rules over providence, but He ordains providence like a machine to work in such a way that prayer is one of the necessary cogs that unfolds the will of God. I believe one of the great reasons why there is a demise in the church in our country is because we don't have corporate prayer. We don't have it. We don't trust God to hear our feeble prayers. It doesn't interest us as much because we're just praying together. Some of it's redundant. Some of it's difficult. We lose our track of mind, our train of thought. It's hard to be consistent. We come for 1 week or 2 weeks, and then we don't come anymore. If I were to say to you in this room that there's a button just appeared on that wall. And on that button it said, whoever presses this, right, all kinds of souls will be saved. All kinds of missionaries will be sent out and will succeed. The pastor's word will go forth with power. Every single one in this room who's a Christian would run to that button as fast as you could to press that button. You wouldn't hesitate. And yet God says he uses prayer to accomplish all those things. And we got 1 and 2 and 3 people at most showing up on a Thursday night to pray. When I first came to this church, there were 2 things that I said were the most important things to me. One was evangelism, which we're lacking in, to be honest. And the other was prayer. We need those things. If you want a pastor in this church who just ministers the word of God to you on Sundays, and that's all, and I can study in my room, that's not the kind of pastor I'm going to be. I want to be spent for Christ. And I want to serve God the other 6 days of the week for this church. Put me to work. Put me to work. Pray with me. That lies the armor of God. The only armor that is sufficient to withstand the type of evil, wicked, powerful opposition that we face. Let us therefore take Paul's charge soberly and with strong conviction. We cannot be ignorant of these things, brethren, lest we be caught off guard. May it never be that we would underestimate or ignore the fact that principalities, powers, and spiritual rulers of darkness are constantly set toward our destruction, intentional on our destruction. May the threat be so severe that we take not the enemy's schemes for granted, and we always seek to put on this armor of God daily, consciously making that effort. And may we yet rest confidently in the arms of our beloved Savior, who has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. For he has granted us such a great victory in his atonement that we can storm the gates of hell and rescue the lost, for the gates of hell will not prevail against us. Another text that's often misused. That text has to do with us entering into the gates of hell to rescue the lost. Not coming against us. In this sense, it's proactive. And it will not resist us. If we would enter into those gates, Christ will give us the victory. I want to encourage you to read, maybe a homework assignment, and I'm going to close with this. Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Verses 42 to the end of this chapter. I want you to think about this and meditate on this text this week. Because we look at the early church and the success of the church. It was imperfect. But God was adding to their number daily those who were being saved. We have a blueprint for success here. Listen to this blueprint. Now, we don't do miracles and signs and wonders today. The gospel has come in. The new covenant has come in. The foundation is laid. We're not bringing in a new covenant. But listen to what it says here. And they, this is a description, a summary description of the church, of the early church. Here it is. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. There it is, the word of God, the preaching, the teaching. And the fellowship, the gathering together of the body, fellowshipping, encouraging one another in God's word. To the breaking of bread, taking the supper together, which we do every Sunday. And the prayers. Praying together. And awe came upon every soul.
And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles, and all who believed were together and had all things in common. We like to write this verse off and say, well, that's, people misuse it, and they do. Communism, right? This is voluntary here. I realize that. But they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, not just Sunday, day by day, they attended the temple together and breaking bread in their homes. They received their food with gladness and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. We have the blueprint. You cannot live a Sunday once a week Christianity and expect to see these kinds of results. It has to be your life. Yes, you have to work your jobs. Yes, we have to care for our homes. Yes, there's time to travel here and there and do those kinds of things. Yes. But the life in the church was the life of the people. Day by day. Not just gathered at the temple. Yes. Or in the synagogue, but in their homes, giving themselves to the teaching of the apostles, fellowshipping, breaking of bread, and praying together, not just on Sunday, one time after a meal. This armor is only effective if you're truly in Christ. Just having a profession of faith grants no such promises. There are many people who have a profession of faith in Christ who are in hell right now. They've said the prayer. Jesus says, many will say to me today, Lord, we've done miracles. There are people who have done miracles in Christ's name in some sense. Or at least give the appearance, whatever it might be. And he says, I never knew you. True faith in Christ is lived out in the ever-growing, ever-repenting, ever-self-sacrificing life. You cannot live a life for Christ if your focus is not on the apple of his eye, which is in the church and in the building of his kingdom. If you're outside of Christ, I want to exhort you today to seek him with all your heart, to cry out to him and ask him to save you from your sins and to reconcile you to God. Wherever you are, wherever you've been, you can't atone for, you can't change your past, you can't undo what you've done. But you have a Savior who was crucified, who became man, God, and was crucified to deal with what we cannot deal with. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent and be saved. And you will have access to this armor. You'll be rescued from the deception of the one who deceives the whole world. You will serve a good purpose, and you will get to the end of your life, even though you never won a World Series with a baseball team, even though you never fulfilled having a successful movie, even though most people don't know your name, even though you didn't have $1,000 hardly to live to your name for months, to hear God say to you, well done, good and faithful servant, is worth more than all that and everything else. Come to Christ and be saved if you're unsaved today. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you so much for your grace to us. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this armor that you have given us. And while there's a sense of sobriety that comes to us in recognizing that we have a responsibility to put it on, there's also a great joy and delight and rest in knowing that it's wholly accessible. This armor doesn't lie behind laser beams or steel doors. It comes to us freely. We access it freely and completely through Christ. Help us, Father, to put it on. We can't even do that on our own. Give us grace to be a church that lives for your glory. Father, do not let anything that was said here today drift away or dissipate from our hearts. Bring conviction, bring change. Build your church. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.